You had something you wanted to say.
Welcome to Phosphorus Podcast.
Okay. Well said. NFTs.
Yeah. NFTs. I like it. I hate it. Like, look, the whole time.
Do tell.
Just, yeah, it's just bugging my mind, man.
Why?
Buying any kind of art is cool.
Mm-hmm.
You cannot talk about anybody's taste in things because that's what they do.
Mm-hmm.
But the question just arose in my mind earlier. You have this money. How much was the worth of that last biggest NFT? Some gorilla punk or punk ape or something like that. It's got sold for like 13 Ethereum or something crazy, maybe even 30 Ethereum. And I'm thinking, what happened to those good old days where the thieves were trying to steal these old antique paintings from the Louvre Museum or something, you know, and then trying to sell it for like a 200 million.
Mm.
So if you can buy a Picasso for 200 to 500 million, why are you paying 50 to 100 million to an NFT? Yes, it's going to be very useful.
Okay,
in
but
the
that
future.
Doesn't happen very often, though.
It doesn't happen, but the only
I don't
reason
have the numbers
it doesn't
on hand, but let's say it's still a lot of money.
Because it's not just about the money anymore. It was fiat money at the beginning. When we are talking about the fiat money, as in 200 million, you are thinking about a lot of cash to be moved around, right? So it's like a lot. But now when it's in crypto terms, if you buy that Ethereum when it was $5 or $2.
Yeah.
But that $13.
There aren't too many people out
that
there.
That $13, that's the joke. Like, that's the joke of the NFT. That's why I want to bring it back to it. And that's how I found out.
What?
The reason why
it's for the people that bought in really cheap.
Yeah, but that's because for them, it's kind of like a sticker. It's a joke. You know?
Oh, yeah, for them. If they were maybe even getting an interest rate of tens of thousands of ETH, for sure. Yeah. Not a joke, but very little money.
For a miner. It's the biggest investment he can make. It's crazy because he had all that Ethereum. Mm-hmm. He has been mining it, right? And after that, he got all of this, maybe even 13 a day.
Mm-hmm.
And for him, it's nothing. And then it's worth a lot, and then he's buying that. So it's not like actually a lot of money, of course, the NFT. A couple of millions or
even
35
million. In some ways, it's only ever been Ethereum. You know what I mean? Their history of ownership of that asset has only ever been, it's just Ethereum. Or not, it's just Ethereum. But my point is that it was never money before it was Ethereum. There's never a transfer or an exchange. So
how do you put value on it?
You think about it different. Yeah, I mean, well, people laugh, right? So, but if you're the kind of person that's mining it and you think about it as not so much a store of value, but I guess, just a unit of value.
I mean, look, I think it's good for the community of people who are artists and they were trying to sell their designs.
For sure.
There's a lot of digital artists too.
The reason that I'm really glad we talked about this is because beforehand, we used to purchase, let's be honest, if you purchased images most of the time in digital format, you're doing so for self-promotion. You're doing so for commonly the purpose of making more money. You wanted to use these images commercially. And now we're talking about people paying thousands of dollars for something to just own it and collect it in a digital way. And that's like in regards to art. And it's very, very interesting. It's very interesting because just when you think, oh, it's dropped off, you know, remember what was it, July-ish, when it dropped back down, June, July, because it took off in March and February and January, right? And, you know, you're thinking like, okay, it's going to die. It's done. You know, people have digital pieces of the blockchain with art in them, but it's not really worth as much as it was. And then all of a sudden here we are again and it's surging again. And you have, you know, people like or games or programs and projects like Axie Infinity to thank for that. Bro. And you know more about gaming in regards to NFTs than I do. So
we are cleaning out a generation, Cory.
Huh?
We are cleaning out a generation.
You think so?
This is what we are doing. Like, I want you to have a look at this image that I have in my mind.
Cool.
I'm back home in Turkey. There's stacks of fucking CDs next to my computer.
Yeah. Stacks of CDs.
Yeah, stacks of CDs, games. Okay. Games, music, video. And then chilling, looking outside the window and like enjoying my time listening to some music and stuff.
It's summer.
Yeah, and then the cleaning lady comes in here. Our helper lady.
Yeah.
not our servant. We're against that. It's just like, I think the janitor or something that helping us. And then she start wiping the dust off the CDs. And we come from that time to make all these things disappear and try to teach them, all right, guys, everything's on a USB now. So we get the object information, like a CD or a disc or etc. We turn it into something smaller and we start producing them and showing it to the people. And they're like, how does this work?
Yeah,
they couldn't even operate a press play, go next. And after that, another couple of years later, then it become the phone technology. And that's how people start catching up to the word digital. Because the digital, that's when you were talking, that's when I was laughing to myself. I'm picturing a family having like a electronic clock with a little picture in it. So they can put like one or two pictures from their USB and then it will show that. And then you're like, all right, you know about digital? Look, yeah, I have digital art.
But that's what we thought about digital art, right? Yeah. And you asked yourself, you would have asked yourself like 5, 6, 7 years ago, you'd be like, why would you pay for something that you might put in a digital photo frame, but you might not because it's actually not really there and it exists on a blockchain. You know, you wouldn't have purchased that for the sake of having it back then. And here we are. Here we are. But with regards to gaming, sell it to me. Why do you hate it? Why do you love it?
I mean, first of all, the NFT, I want to say that quickly on that, is a must. Because there is a way, we need to have a way to keep art somewhere that we can enjoy anytime. I don't want to move this, let's say, okay, I'm going to move houses. How am I going to move this old antique painting? Of course, it's good. It's not like their industry going to die because that's still antique and that's still worthy. And people who do that job, they will still have their money. But the NFT is also a fast way to own something like an asset and start selling it. But anyway, in the gaming world, the idea is this. Are we trying to be historic or are we trying to make history? Are we going to keep looking at the past and look at the way that people did something and keep appreciating it that way? Or are we going to evolve? And this is the steps of evolving to a different option.
I really like that. Is that that line?
It's mine.
Is it?
Yes.
That's pretty good.
Thank you.
You should be proud. I like that.
Thank you. So I was thinking, is it like antique versus the new? Or is it Picasso versus the Gorilla Punk NFT? Or a Petrarch versus the Lonely Ape?
So right now the assets, right? What was it? I don't remember. It was like $100,000. Yeah. It was Visa. Wasn't it Visa or PayPal that just
Visa? Oh, Visa. Visa just purchased.
Visa just purchased $160,000.
Yeah, they added it to their collection.
Bored Ape Yacht Club. For their, they use it as their avatar.
Yeah.
Right?
Because they understood they are looking for a way to sell it to the community too. Because
it's going to be worth money.
The thing is this, right? We are coming to a new age, and we talk about it in our last couple episodes too. It's the digital age. Our phones are getting smaller. Our needs for technical objects are getting lower because we can find it all in one. Like before, long time ago, even this was a fucking big production. You know, until then, people didn't have it, didn't know how to do it, or didn't even take the time to do it. And that's the thing. We don't take the time to do any fucking shit as humankind. We like to keep our mouths open and just keep getting fed, right? So I was pondering again today. I love this lockdown. So it's like nonstop lockdown means nonstop pondering, right? We are always chasing this tomorrow. Tomorrow, 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 tomorrow. Come here tomorrow. And then when you are getting frustrated with tomorrow, you turn back and look in the past and start looking for happiness. But the poor today, the poor present, always gets fucking lonely. The present is always using your trash, your autopilot, your way of survival of finishing the day and just getting to bed and finally having a successful day and then sleeping, because tomorrow takes your happiness. You are looking for tomorrow, more options, more possibilities. And your yesterday is also valuable to you, but ruling the present, ruling your now is the way to do whatever the fuck you want in this world. And that's what we are getting at. That's why the fast pace is happening. It's daily, it's momentary, it's second. Who you met, who you see, what you write, what time you write, who sees it. These are all very important shit.
Being ahead of something.
And they found it now because, good, people made so much money. This is what we were also saying. I want to connect it to that too. People bought this Bitcoin when it was fucking $100 or $1,000 too.
Yeah.
And now they are rich. They had so much money. Mm-hmm. And that money has to go somewhere. Because if you keep on giving this gambler, because there are some gamblers in it too. If you keep on giving that one product,
I don't think those people... Okay, so you think those people bought on a gamble? Well,
No. I mean, not on a gamble. But even if they didn't understand, they believed in a technology and the new wave of things, it will work in the future.
At what price do you think?
I think at between a 1 to 10. Up to $10. I think after that, then it become like a business thing. When the sharks, they start seeing $100 or $150, they're like, hold on. There's a chance this is going to go big. Let's start playing around with it.
Okay.
So it got manipulated, I think. But I'm not calling people dumb. But the thing is, it's fast-paced world and we have to motivate ourselves. So in the gaming world, coming back to our topic, our gaming world is very important for me because I'm a long-time gamer. And the thing is, there are a lot of people like that. I spent around 10 hours of my day just playing games like Silent Hill, Pro Evolution Soccer, Metal Gear Solid, and then came the Warcraft and the Starcraft, and you play all these games, Age of Empires, and then, wow, imagine we were there, because that's also a generation gap now too.
Mm-hmm.
We were there, we played it, it was the beginning of the computer technology, the gaming world started, and then the console start entering the game with PlayStation and Xbox, and before that it was like Sega Cast or something like that, a lot of the Dreamcast. Atari. So they did it, and that was all our time. What happened to all that fucking experience and the time spent? We never got anything out of it. Like, especially as World of Warcraft players, we never got anything out of it.
I don't know, dude. I think if you gamed when, let's go back as far as Nintendo.
Yeah.
Original on Nintendo, a Game Boy. Sega 16.
Okay, still on a console. Yeah.
So let's say you started then. We, as gamers then, we got everything we wanted, like on a 12-month basis. You know what I mean? Like it was Christmas for years. They came out with technology so fast. You know, Sega Dreamcast, we had Sega, Sony PlayStation in no time.
Let's say in the next 5 years, I have a kid and my kid can sit down in front of a screen, watch the videos, of all the games that are out there. Pick one, click another place, download it right away, play it there. If something is wrong with the computer, can order something directly from online, get it delivered in 2 days or in the same day too.
Yeah, same day.
Even get them to fix it on site. And then this kid is getting everything, bam, 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 like this. I want a candy. I want an M&M candy. All right, let me check the shop. So? Before, it was like this.
I know guys that have built their own setup from
they did,
piece by piece.
But that was a trick because you couldn't order it before like this. You had to go to the shops. You have to go to the distributors.
Yeah.
You have to travel there physically. And to go there means taking your parents with you there. And that time you don't have the money. If you had the money, they already fucking help you do it anyway.
Fair enough. It's a fair assumption. That's a fair assumption. But dude, you can't deny that it helped. It happened so fast.
The gaming world today is created by us.
Yeah,
because
that's true.
We played it, and the people like us and older than us too, because I see the other generation jumping on it so bad, because imagine the time they were so bored by themselves in life, and suddenly they're like games.
Imagine the imagination they must have though, like and be limited.
Imagine,
you know,
the imagination.
N64 came out and you said everything you think about has to be N64. We have this small team of people thinking about N65 or, you know, like GameCube, but you know, everybody's got to stay within this ecosystem. The imaginations that you must have had, like running wild at that time, like if only we could do that.
I watched it. Yeah. I observed them. That's how I learned it. I saw like a normal businesswoman at her office. It was my father's wife's office. And suddenly this lady just brings out the joystick and start playing some flight simulator. And having so much fun. And when you ask, like, hey, can I play? Like, no, you wait your turn. Because they were waiting whole day to play with that too. And they were like people our age now.
Yeah.
Mid-30s, 40s.
Yeah, don't get me wrong.
Those people already provided us the path to start this technology and bring it forward. So they passed us the torch. And by playing it, by talking about it, by buying all the PC gamer magazines, etc., we supported the community.
So you think
The gamers, I mean, this is the we.
Yeah.
All the gamers.
So
in
you
the
think
world.
There's an audience for us to get into NFTs as well? Like, well, NFT? It's a broad spectrum then.
Yeah, of course, because now a 12-year-old is reading about NFT.
So it's definitely a good thing.
I mean, it's definitely a good thing, but it's going to get out of hand too.
You think so? Why?
I predict like someone going to lose a lot of money. Like people already losing money from the gas fees, from minting it, from buying it, from keeping it.
But that's going to, supposedly, that could change.
Ethereum 2.0 and the layer 2 solutions to the payment systems, the transaction
system.
Okay,
maybe it's not Ethereum though. Maybe it's somebody else comes in and says, you know what, we do that. Hey.
I mean, they are just minting it on Ethereum. They can do it on another blockchain too if they want to.
Yeah, but there's no gas. Imagine, you know, you have plenty of competitors out there that significantly reduce, if not eliminate, gas
fees. The market going to balance.
Huh?
The market going to balance for sure. Like we are talking about all this in the middle of a bull market. Like the year of a bull year, we can't predict it because the real face of all of these investments are going to show themselves in the next 2 years.
Dude, I think this year's only a bull year if it hits a new all-time high. I can't think. I don't think you can call it a bull year now because you went back down to
December
28.5. Okay, fine. Mm. But if that's your prediction, then okay. But if you say like even without that, it's been a bull year, no.
I mean, it's not going to be a profitable year for us, for the people who got in this year.
I think it could be.
I mean, a bit, you know, but that's the greed factor. Like how much do you want out of this?
Because, yeah, that's true. That's true. And why are you in it to begin with, right?
I mean, you want to make some money out of it, of course. But if you are looking for getting like 20, 50X right away, maybe you're going to be disappointed. You will have that 50X in 3-4 years for sure.
You think
so? Yeah. I mean, that's the whole idea behind it because the technology is not going anywhere. It's not going back.
Yeah.
It's going forward.
Yeah.
Even if the government comes in, regulates it, centralized exchanges, DeFi is getting hacked, people are getting scammed, it's going to continue because it's the new way.
Yeah.
And it's going to be pushed.
I think it'll get better.
That's right. So but invest in it now.
We'll see. We'll see what happens.
For sure.
What happens.
So okay. The gaming world, so coming back to the gaming world, right?
Yeah.
It was PC versus console. It was the PC gaming or the console gaming.
Yeah.
And now, after the smartphones got super smart, now we have the mobile technology, the mobile gaming technology, right? So this is how the NFT games are getting involved.
Mm-hmm.
And in a way, basically, I look at it like a yield farm.
Mm-hmm.
You just invest in it and then you have a chance to get more tokens by secret APYs. You know, you open this chest, you get this coin, you get this card and you can sell that NFT.
Yeah.
So that's good because that's what essentially online players in the gaming world, that's what they did anyway. They were farming for items. They were selling the items and they had their
own. But people are going to lose a lot of money then.
I mean, people already did because before, I'm a gamer. I'm in this community, right?
Mm.
Before you can hear in an internet shop, oh my God, I dropped this sword. Look at this sword. And you can sell that sword.
Mm.
And then you are looking for somebody to buy it through chat or something. And then you send the item online and they don't send you the money back and done. Gone. So the NFTs are kind of providing a system for the gamers to finally get something out of it.
Yeah.
And upon those news, China already stopped the online gaming for the children, put some restrictions for the weekly amount of time they can play. I mean, it's connected because like Asian gamers are already known in the gaming community as very fast paced and long time playing players. They're always good. That's why, like, I think the Koreans, they dominate the StarCraft area. I think the Tekken is kind of Japan or Korea also.
Yeah.
China already in a lot of MMO games. And even in the Dota 2 that we play, the Chinese teams are really good.
Yeah.
So as a community,
as a different region,
right? The way they do things are very different. And that's what makes them excel. So this is the community that has been mining crypto, not the kids. The adults, they have been mining like crazy.
Yeah, but
you are watching documentaries on them.
Yeah.
How these workers are sleeping inside of the mining factory.
Mm-hmm.
They are being paid high salaries to stay inside there and live there.
Mm-hmm.
They literally basically don't have time because they sleep, they work, they go outside, have a cigarette or maybe a couple hours, buy something and come back and take care of this whole five, six floors.
Caretaker kind of.
Yeah. So they have the efficiency to work.
So with regards to the NFTs, do you think that what? That makes it unfair?
I mean, it's not making it unfair. That's why China banned it, because they don't want the whole fucking next generation to be just looking at their phones
crazy.
Of course.
Know. I don't think that's the reason.
Like, look.
I think it's something that looks good on top, but I think there's another reason underneath. Like,
the thing is, first of all, these games that people play, let's say in China, I don't know what is the censor limit there. Mm. Either they are backed up by the Chinese developers, or if the Chinese people want to play some game outside of that server, then you are giving away information. Like, China is against releasing information, and they are very strict about
it. Okay, so they don't want them involved.
Because getting the information from the kid is easier.
Screen time.
Okay. I mean, there's a reason they let go of the mining.
So it's a double.
There's a reason they do this, and I think it's related with their road and belt strategy coming up, or they're already on the way.
It's a double-edged sword.
Yeah, but for the gaming world, we are talking about this. You can go to the toilet, and while you're doing your business, you can just get your phone and start playing some game.
And making money.
And eventually make money. It starts slow, because every game that you need to play in the NFT gaming, it wants some kind of deposit. Mm-hmm. Like, you need to invest in the game to get from the game. It's not like, okay, let me just open it and try so hard and maybe I will get one. No, you have to invest a certain amount to start getting the normal level services.
Okay.
You know what I mean? And maybe you have to buy a pet, maybe you have to buy a card, maybe you have to buy a subscription, whatever.
It keeps you in the game. And that's,
but that is the same kind of investment. So you do it and you start playing it and there's no harm in it. But the click-to-buy problem in online gaming on the phones has been a problem ever since I was a kid. Ever since these phones came out and the online payment system become just one click on the phone, these news are not fucking mainstream anymore, because they don't want to talk about it anymore.
Yeah.
It was kind of like, okay, shit, my kid just purchased $1,000 worth of costume for Simpsons game. I want to cancel it. No, madam, we cannot do it, because it was from your phone and you authorized it. No.
We can do that, but it's a 5% fee.
Yeah, so now the kids even have their own accounts. They can just get the credit card numbers, whatever they do, and then they start doing it. And I think that's a way to stop it, but I'm against every kind of constriction. But in the gaming world, what I'm looking forward to is MMO. MMO world has to come into the NFT part and kind of collaborate together. Like, I want to be able to sell some of my items in World of Warcraft. Because I played it for so many years and I have some of the original items too. And imagine Blizzard or Activision at this time, with lots of shit that is happening under their name because of World of Warcraft and their open case with the California court. That's another thing. Because of the sexual harassment and the frat boy culture.
Blizzard, no?
Blizzard is owned by Activision. Okay. Blizzard, original Blizzard, was the fucking
StarCraft
leader of this gaming world. Diablo, StarCraft.
Diablo 2.
Yeah. Sure. And then the Warcraft and then the World of Warcraft. Okay. So they were really good. But they are going to come in and I want to be able to sell those items, or not even sell, just to see its worth, to see some worth in your life. And I think this is when it's going to go crazy for the gaming, when big companies like Steam, Activision, or even the Rockstar Games. I don't know if they have. I know the Ubisoft, they have their online. Yeah.
GTA 6 is out of this world.
Online
amazing.
Companies, they're going to integrate into the NFT world. And I think that's when we are going to see this explosion. Yeah, for sure.